for those who don't know Bits for Freedom, we are the equivalent to the EFF from the US and Privacy International from the UK. At the end of this talk, you will be somewhat familiar with the two battlegrounds for the crypto wars that is upcoming. So you notice probably my shirt has the title of this talk. And the idea is that all of you know that if you have a vulnerability and you want to make sure it headlines the evening news, then make a nice logo of it. I'm not good with Illustrator, so I thought let's create a t-shirt and let's make it viral as well. The first thing I want to talk about is the reform of the Dutch Intelligence and Security Act. So that's the Dutch rules that govern the Dutch intelligence services. We have two of them, the AIVD and the MIVD, which is the internal and the foreign intelligence services. And this proposal that has, there's just a draft. The proposal needs to send to the parliament, that still needs to be done. But this draft already outlines many important changes. And one of that is the introduction of dragnet surveillance, which means that the both intelligence services will get the power to do untargeted wiretapping. So now, at this moment, they can wiretap my internet connection if they think that I'm planning a terrorist attack. But they are not allowed to wiretap an entire city if they want to search that data. With this draft, if that would be approved, then the AIVD, the Dutch intelligence services, may be wiretapping entire cities or the Wi-Fi in a train or whatever in order to search through that data and hopefully find someone that does plan an attack. If, of course, where you have to target it, then it's only one person who is already a suspect will be targeted. But if it's untargeted, then most of the communications will be of people who have done nothing wrong at all. Another thing is that another concern with the new law, with the new proposal, is the sharing of raw data with other intelligence services. So, with the new power of untargeted surveillance, they get a lot of data, and they would be allowed to share it with other intelligence services like the NSA or the GCHQ. This also includes the raw data. There's even data they didn't process or analyze themselves, they didn't even have a look at it. They may be allowed to share it with other intelligence communities. That also, so that is very important to them, because in the intelligence communities, the only way to get a lot of data from other intelligence services is by sharing a lot of data with them. And that would be, well, like I said, raw data, and it even includes the data of Dutch citizens themselves, not only the foreign data, because they say that's also very helpful to those other services. So they can get a lot of data with untargeted surveillance and then share all the data with other intelligence communities all over the world. And also another thing on that new proposal is that it extends the power to hack into a computer to third parties. So right now the Dutch intelligence services may hack into my computer if they see me as a suspect for a terrorist attack. But if I would be able to defend against that, but they would be able to get via the computer of someone else onto my computer systems, then in the new proposal they would be allowed to do that. That introduces all kinds of liability issues. For example, if your infrastructure is used to hack into the computer of a suspect, the suspect notices that attack, it will research where it comes from, and it will be attributed to you. You, of course, don't know of anything because it was a secret service that hacked into your systems to hack that other person. So you have something to explain. And I'm pretty sure that the Dutch intelligence services will not step up and say, hey, that was us, please ignore that man in the middle. So this is a problem as well. And one thing that is overlooked in many of the critiques is that the requirement to obligate with the intelligence services is no longer voluntary, but will be a requirement in the future. So now if the intelligence services want to wiretap they can wiretap a telco, so they can wiretap a KPN or a Ziggo, but they cannot require a wiretap from WhatsApp, so they cannot gather the real-time data. If this proposal is being approved, that would change, and that same requirement would apply to WhatsApp's or Apple with iMessage and all that kind of services. I'll get back to that in a second. At the same time, oh sorry, one more thing. So people have asked me what's the status of this proposal. Right now the proposal is with the Raad van State, which is the Council of State, and which gives the government constitutional advice on this proposal. That's very important and very clear advice, very usually, but the government has a tendency to just simply ignore that. This has been taking surprisingly long, the creating of this advice, but if it's sent to the government, then the government will need to process the commentary and then create a new draft of the law and send that to Parliament. There's one other interesting thing here. In May next year, we have general elections in the Netherlands, and as this is some kind of a toxic a topic, I would not be surprised that the government sends this bill to the Parliament only after the elections, just to avoid a lot of deep public debate in the around the elections. So they are in a hurry with this law, but maybe because of the elections, it will be delayed for half year or a year. Well, at the same time, in the Europe, there's also a lot of changing. This is Juncker, he is the head of the European Commission, and the European Commission has set out for a review of the e-privacy directive. And a directive is, I'll explain to you in a second what it is, but the directive, you need to know that's something, that it's a law in Europe, but it needs to be translated into the legislation of a member state. So it outlines what the national laws should look like. It is different from a regulation which has directly binding impact on the member states. So, but they want to reform that e-privacy directive. And that e-privacy directive that regulates the telecom providers. So think of KPN and Ziggo or Sky in the UK. It does not, right now it does not regulate the over-the-top services, so it's only limited to telecom providers. And it aims to a high level of protection for citizens and a level playing field for all market players. And it does so by introducing rules on security and rules on the confidentiality of communications. Both are, from a civil rights point of view, welcome, but of course they impose extra rules on the telecom providers. On top of that, there's Article 15 of the e-privacy directive, and that one is also very interesting, as it allows member states to put restrictions on that, on those requirements on security and confidentiality, if that is necessary for national security and/or the prosecution of criminal offences. What it means, I'll show you now with the implementation of this directive in the Dutch legislation. So, as this is the telecoms package, it is translated to the Telecoms Act in the Netherlands. And all Dutch people in the audience know about the term de aanbieders van openbare telecommunicatienetwerken. And it also introduces, on the top of that Article 15, a requirement for those providers to be able to wiretap their networks. If they're not able to wiretap the networks, they're not to, allowed to provision it, to sell it. And this Telecom Act works in conjunction with the Penal Code, and in the Penal Code there's one other thing which is added to that, which is a requirement to be able to, so a requirement to decrypt. and that the decryption requirement only works for the encryption that is applied by that provider. So I think a very simple example for that is if you have an SMTP session from a client to your server that has TLS on it, that TLS is will end on your box, so you will, so you have the key material, so you can provide the law enforcement with the unencrypted information. So if they ask, you have to do that. Of course, it also means that if the client is sending end-to-end encrypted messages, like PGP in mail, then of course the provider and law enforcement will end up with the encrypted information because they don't, because the provider doesn't have the keys to that end-to-end encryption. The purpose of the review of that e-privacy directive is what they are saying, aimed at reinforcing trust and security in digital services in the European Union, with a focus on ensuring a high level of protection for citizens and a level playing field for all market players. Again, it sounds very, it's a long sentence anyway, and it sounds very lofty, but it doesn't really tell you what they're talking about. But what they're talking about, one thing, is the question, is the debate whether that e-privacy directive, whether that should cover the over-the-top services as well. So should VoIP solutions be included? Should WhatsApp included, or an iMessage of Apple, should that be should that be covered by the e-privacy directive as well? The telecom providers they applaud that proposal because they say, okay, right now if you send a text message from my phone to your phone, then that would be covered by both the general privacy regulations, but also the e-privacy directive, which is an additional layer of regulations in order to increase the confidentiality of the messages. But if I would send you an iMessage, then that's over-the-top services, then that only is covered by the general data protection regulation and not by the e-privacy rules. So KPNs and Ziggo's and all those other telecom operators, they say, yes, the e-privacy should be extended to cover over-the-top services because that will create a level playing field. Of course, all those over-the-top services are opposing that because they don't want to have additional regulation where they have to adhere to. And then one other thing which is important to keep in the back of your mind when thinking about this e-privacy directive review is the proposal that was made by the French Interior Minister Castaneuve and his colleague from Germany. They were asking the European Commission like 2 weeks ago to research the possibilities of a requirement for wiretapping to WhatsApp and Apple to include that in the e-privacy directive in that review. Again, nice words for that, because it would truly arm our democracies on the issue of encryption. Basically, he's asking to break end-to-end encryption with applications like WhatsApp and Telegram. So, why would you care? Well, let's have a look at the worst-case scenario that could happen here. So, let's say the scope indeed is broadened to cover over-the-top players. And let's look at that with the Dutch translation of this e-privacy directive in mind. Then maybe this e-privacy review would also start to introduce a requirement for wiretapping over the top services. And maybe it would also include a requirement for decryption by over the top services. And that changes a lot because right now, like I said before, if you have two clients and you have the provider in the middle, in the center of it, then if the if you send a message from one client to the other, and it will be encrypted with the light green here, with TLS, for example, that must be decrypted by the provider right now. And the dark green, if it's encrypted end-to-end, then the provider will see encrypted blob. If it's unencrypted, they will get the plain text. But if this worst case scenario is applied, then this would happen. Because WhatsApp, for example, as a provider, also reaches out to my mobile. If I have the WhatsApp client installed, they are the ones who are deciding what is actually run on my phone. And if that happens, then also their reach for decryption is increased until my phone and the other end's phone. And that means that end-to-end encryption would possibly become broken because it would be there would be a requirement for decryption. That could be done by adding an additional key to a master key to every encrypted communication. But another solution would be, for example, to have everything securely end-to-end encrypted all the time, unless you're the target of a investigation, in which case WhatsApp could be required to disable the end-to-end encryption for all communications from your phone. That could be done, for example, by pushing out an update to your phone, and that would be a very bad idea, in my opinion, because that would make people no longer trust updates, especially not security updates, which I think is important that the trust is there. And of course, any lawyer would tell me right away that the European Commission does not have the competence to create rules on national security for member states. So when the European Union was made, there was a decision that national security is something of the member states and not something that the European Union governs. But of course, lawyers are lawyers and they will find a workaround for that, and they would not create such a e-privacy directive, a new one, under the guise of saying that it introduces rules on national security, but they would say we need those rules for harmonizing the legislation in all of the member states, and by doing so creating a level playing field. So it's more of an economic argument than a national security, and then it is okay for the European Commission to introduce this regulation, this kind of legislation. And that's not very far-fetched, because this is apart from the Data Retention Directive, and it was exactly done that way. It says several member states have adopted legislation providing for retention of data. Those national provisions, they vary considerably. The legal and technical differences between the national provisions concerning the retention of data for the purpose of blah blah, present obstacles for the internal market. So it says, because there's a patchwork of legislation all over the member states, that creates obstacles, so we need to fix that. So we're going to create legislation that harmonizes all those that patchwork. And by doing so, they can also create rules on national security, although they are actually not allowed. With the e-privacy directive, there are many different ways to do that. Maybe it will be updated to a regulation. If so, then the new regulation would apply to all member states right away. Maybe it will be kept a directive, in which case all member states need to transpose those rules. And maybe there's still such a Article 15 left in there. If the OTT is included, but the encryption is not, then maybe that can be done on member state level. If that is done, if it's only the Netherlands, then I'm pretty sure that WhatsApp will say, fuck you. But if it's Ireland, where they are legally having their head office in Europe, then they can't say that, and then they will be creating something that allows them to real-time look into your messages. And if in Ireland that is done, then of course the Dutch will follow as well. That's one of the battlegrounds, I think, for the next crypto wars in Europe. And I'm pretty sure it will be a fairly ugly fight as well. Because there needs to be only one terrorist attack extra, and then everything is rushed through the European Parliament and we're done. And if terrorism doesn't work, then of course there's always this other argument which always works. Thank you. So that's where we are right now in Europe. And then there's also the chance that in the Netherlands we have the honor of fighting that fight even earlier, because if Minister Plasterk will push through his proposal for a review of the Dutch intelligence law, he will do so very quickly, then we will have the same fight in the Netherlands before we have the same fight in Europe again. So that's why I need all of you to speak up. It is very, very important that people with technical backgrounds explain what exactly entails if you would extend that definition of providers to over-the-top players. Because the legislators, most of them don't have too much technical knowledge, so they cannot really tell how a particular proposal will impact technology. And even if they would, probably terrorism is way too strong an argument, and that would force them to still approve such a proposal. So we need people, in order to fight back, we need people with technical knowledge and that can explain what actually is being done and why it hurts the internet in general, or digital infrastructure in general, and why it would hurt the trust of consumers in our digital infrastructure. And I think that because, for example, that e-privacy directive review has only started, now is a good moment, because the longer you wait, the harder it will be to make big changes to that approach. Officially, there's no draft of a new e-privacy directive yet, and that means that still a lot can be changed. If you would start to speak up in a year, then you'd probably be too late, because then there's already a draft and there will be only minor changes possible. So please, please speak up, and if you need help in getting through to the politicians in Brussels or in The Hague, come to me and I'll help you. That's what I wanted to tell you, so now question everything.
Thank you, Rayo. Very much appreciated that you're giving Thank us you. An overview of things that are going on in this problem space.
Problem space.
Hi, I'm Will, I'm speaking for myself. I just got like a side information from what's going on in Switzerland. And on the 25th of September, we will vote on something that's quite close to what you mentioned at the beginning. So law that allows the cops to go and sniff your device, blah, 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 terrorism, blah, 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 fear. And so we should also be careful about that, because that's kind of risky if you got like data in Switzerland and you were thinking that it was safe. Well, we're not sure that it's going to be that safe in the future because of the same stuff. So you should, well, just a side information for that.
Yeah. So this is so all these debates are happening more or less the same in every country all over the world, I would even say. So the question on whether WhatsApp whether you should be able to decrypt that end-to-end connections, that's something which a debate which is going on in the US, but at the same time it's happening on a European level, as in with the European Commission and European Parliament, but it's also happening next to that on a national level. So there are many separate debates you need to take care of, yeah.
Philip Homber, speaking for myself. So I've a comment on sort of the WhatsApp example you gave, and sure. That's you said, well, maybe WhatsApp will push a different application to your phone. And yep. I think that that's feels a bit to me like a straw man, because if there's one thing you don't want as an intelligence service or something, is that your target knows that you're doing something. So as soon as you start pushing either different configurations or different applications to, say, criminals or other people you suspect, and people will write code to detect that, then you're dead in the water. And the other thing is, of course, they want to do DragNet surveillance, which also doesn't really work if you have to push individual applications. So I'm a bit worried is that if you bring up an example like this, that the other side can say, oh, we promise we will never require that, and then you sort of lost one argument because you brought it up as something you're worried about, and then they can easily say, oh yeah, but we will never do that, even though they already didn't want to do it.
So first of all, I think if they're not planning to do it, then it should not be a provision in the law. So they should rule it out in the law right away. But having said that, I'm not sure whether they would not do that. Of course, you are right that if the intelligence services have someone on their radar and they want to surveil the person, they will try to do that very in a stealth mode, of course. But at the same time, in the current law, there's a provision that allows the intelligence services in the Netherlands to hack into computers of a suspect. That power is being used, we know that for sure. That's something where the same argument would not work, because in that case, if the intelligence services are hacking into a computer, you may notice that. So of course they will always make a risk assessment before doing so. They will always make a risk assessment on whether that target is maybe a very technically knowing person and will be able to detect that, or whether that person is just using a phone that was given him from someone who directs him and that he doesn't know anything at all and just uses that phone. So of course the intelligence services are operating in a stealth mode, but it doesn't say that they will not push a separate configuration to your phone or not hack into your computer, I think.
Yeah, but so at least for me, the more worrying thing is anything that allows DragNet surveillance. So if they have to hack individual computers, then that's something that by and large doesn't scale. So of course the NSA can do it, but it's not even clear that a local police can do it. So that creates a barrier. Like, okay, you can only do it for really serious crimes. I mean, we still don't want them to do it to third parties, but it's self-limiting. Whereas any requirement that, for example, WhatsApp would have to record all traffic and just give up on the current model, I mean, that would be really dangerous to society, because then you get more DragNet surveillance.
No, sure. So that's a very difficult thing in my work, which is a debate every now and then, because preferably we don't want to have someone else hack into your computer, but at the same time we don't want to have DragNet surveillance. So the intelligence and the law enforcement are very often saying, hey, if we cannot do DragNet surveillance, then we need to be able to hack into your computer. If you cannot order WhatsApp to decrypt, then we need to be able to hack into a computer. That is, of course, an argument they are making from time to time. But yeah, that's something I have to deal with. We all have to deal with.
Michael Kolacek speaking for myself. My concern is not really the personal PC network, etc., but it is more like tooling that is being used by the authorities and the possibility of leakage of that tooling. Around 1 month ago, there was a hack attempt on some of Eastern people. They made a reverse engineering and they actually have discovered NSA ghost server, which contained multiple software tools that was using 0 days, was using a lot of holes in the systems, including
Shadow Broker,
Juniper.
You're talking about, right?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
And actually those tools have leaked into the wide public. On that moment, the main risk is not the private use that someone will hack my phone or my PC, but actually the general risk for the whole infrastructures that are standing. Because before the patches are going to be released, et cetera, that will secure it, then that harm will have happened. And also, there are other multiple things like simple problems for the regular people that are being done by the outages of the services during that, or leakage of the private personal data.
Yes, so what I wasn't talking about but is a very important thing is that in my opinion our digital infrastructure needs to be secure as possible. Of course, it can. We all know 100% security is not possible, of course, but everything needs to be done to make sure that it is secure. That means that, in my opinion, a government should not use zero-day vulnerabilities and definitely not store them for long periods of time, as happened with the shadow broker zero days, or the zero days that were included in that. I think that if you look, so in a Dutch situation, the intelligence services already have the ability to hack into a computer, so they maybe already are using zero days or maybe buying them, I don't know. We in the Netherlands, we also have a different proposal, which I didn't mention yet, which is the Wet Computercriminaliteit 3, so which is the cyber criminal law, whatever, that introduces the power for the Dutch police to hack into a computer as well. And what you see now is that there's lots of talk about whether the police should get that power, but there's no talk about when or why a government should be using zero days or vulnerabilities in general in the first place. So we are not talking about if we are okay that the intelligence services can hack into your computer, are we okay they are using zero days for that, or should they, when they come across a zero day, first they should do is notify the developer of that? Or should they be able to use it for half a year and then notify? So all that details, there's no talk about it as of yet, which is very worrying, I think.
Final comment.
Okay, Ron Bersma from the US. How far does your authority go to hack into someone else's computer? Is it just within the country? Is it within the EU? Is it any foreign country? At what point are you violating treaties or whatever?
Yeah, good question. You're asking where my...
for the law within the Netherlands.
Yeah, that's true. So that's a very, very good question, and that's one of the reasons why I think that the Dutch government takes a long time in answering all the questions from Parliament on that new hacking proposal for the Dutch police, because sometimes it's hard to tell where a computer is, like for example a Tor hidden service. Would they be allowed to hack into that computer? Right now, that is not a, in the Netherlands, that is not a sorry. I asked you for water and it still doesn't work. Anyways, so that's something which is still out in the open. We don't know yet what we'll end up with, but there is a chance that that the government or that the parliament will approve a law that would allow the Dutch police to hack into a computer which is located outside of the Dutch jurisdiction. And that is worrisome, and I think that one of the things that should be done in the Netherlands instead of that is focusing on the MLET procedures. So if we want something from a US computer, we need to get, so the Dutch police needs to get in touch with the Dutch, US authorities, and then in the end they will be allowed to get to the data. That's the approach that should be taken. The reason why they're not doing that is because those procedures take a very, very long time. So if you're asking for some traffic data, it may take up to 4 weeks before the answer is returned. That is, of course, way too long in many investigations, I understand that. But instead of improving those procedures, they're looking into hacking because that's way simpler. And that's worrisome, again.